so talks on different topics, starting with the first talk, kind of an overview, and then the AMOA talk with solar fuels. That actually overlaps with talk number 4 or 5 that we're giving, so we'll work something out. I could review some of that, or I could talk about different parts of solar fields. I have many more slides than I showed. But today is, I was going to talk about this, every aspect of polyoxometallates and other materials as well. This extends to metal oxide surfaces, is influenced by the counter ions. So I thought this was a logical thing, and many people have worked with me on this over the years. The main ones are Ira Weinstock, who is a prominent polyoxymetallate chemist today in Israel. He worked with us at Emory for about 12 years, and we had a large team of people and an international consortium of companies in the pulp and paper industry who funded us for several $1 million for about 12 years. And we worked on using POMs and POM systems really to selectively convert wood into paper. So I showed you a couple slides at the beginning in the overview talk. So I'll be looking at some of that fundamental work. Since we're such a small group, if I think it'd be good if any of you something's not clear, just raise your hand, and I'll be happy to answer, and we can have a discussion right there. I don't think that question answer or Q&A will impact the flow of my talk. I'm not worried. So I'm here in India primarily to help discuss and teach about various things. And we'll probably be most effective if you've got questions or whatever to stop and we can go over those. Okay. So counter-ion impact really all POM properties, and the POM community is just getting bigger and bigger. There's just a core of us, and around the country, around the world, that do POMs, but there's a much larger community that has used them and studies them. It's probably over 200 different research groups and companies, but there's a core that has done a lot of the fundamental work of POMs. Okay, so things start out with solubility. So POMs are salts, right? Not unlike sodium chloride. But there's big differences between sodium plus, chloride minus, and, for example, sodium 3, PW12O43 minus. And you can control solubility by what the cations are. So POMs, as you guys know, are usually made in water. So you have sodium salt precursors and potassium, sometimes lithium, sometimes ammonium. And you do the self-assembly at a certain pH in water, and then you precipitate it. Hopefully you can recrystallize it. So crystallization is needed to purify it, usually. There's several ways you purify compounds. Crystallization is usually the nicest. Chromatography is next, but that's more involved. There's no guarantee that if you chromatograph something that it will be pure enough to crystallize. But often that's the thrust. If it won't crystallize directly, then you do chromatography and then try to crystallize it. Now if you have a hydrophobic counterion, not sodium or potassium, but something like TBA, tetrabutylammonium, or TMA, tetrabutylammonium, so TMA, TBA, 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 but also TPA, tetrapentyl, and THPA, tetraheptyl. So tetra and heptyl ammonium is very popular. And the reason for that is, anybody know why THPA, tetraheptyl ammonium is a popular cation? It's popular because all of the common POMs can be extracted effectively in 100% yield from water into an organic layer that is dissolved THPA, the one I showed in our work on water. the UFCs, was THP and Tolly Week. And it just, it's very quantitative. All the PAY1 goes into the Tolly Week. And other things are left in the water. So if you use more hydrophobic cations, then you can make PAY1 soluble in organic solvents. And you know, the more hydrophobic the cation is, the more soluble it is in less polar solvents. So if you make like the TEA, tetraethyl ammonium, or the TPA, tetrapropyl, or TEA, column 1, tetrabutyl, you can, those are not very soluble in toluene, but they are soluble in more polar organic solvents that are still immiscible with water, so the two layers. So if you have water and a chlorocarbon, it's actually like this, because chlorocarbons are tetrabutyl. Unless you have enough tungstate poly-PAY1 in the water, if there's enough, then it goes back and the PAY1 in the water becomes more heavier than the chlorocarbon. But you have another layer and you have the organic cation there and you extract it. Just a point on this, guys. So they usually the most available and the most inexpensive salts, tetraalkyl ammonium salts or halides. But you often don't want halide around, particularly if you're going to be doing catalysis of some kind, because the halide anions are not innocent. So iodide reacts with all kinds of things, so nobody's going to use TBA iodide as a starting material, or TBA iodide. But bromide is also easily oxidized to Br2. And when you oxidize it, Br2 reacts with many things, both thermally and in the dark. Right, we all remember organic chemistry, Br2 adds to double bonds, and on and on and on. So chloride's a little safer because it's much harder to oxidize chloride to chlorine than bromide or iodide. And fluorine you can't oxidize. It's the highest potential of any common thing, right, to make F2. But even chloride can be dangerous. And so what's popular in my group now is we use nitrate salts. Nitrate salts tend to be very soluble in water. So if you use TEA or TBA nitrate, then you're not going to have halide ion hanging around, staying with the POM and compromising some research that you might do later, like organic oxidation. You don't want halide around because halide can start a rapid chain reaction, so you can get allylic oxidation. CH bonds. So you don't want halide around. So you dissolve TXA, tetraheptyl, hexane, tetraheptyl ammonium, nitrate, and toluene, and the POM is now toluene soluble. Now there's not been a lot done yet on fluorocarbon media. This is an area that's interesting in my opinion. So if you use fluorinated cations, fluorinated solvents tend to be insoluble in water, of course. They're often insoluble in organic solvents as well. They have strange solubility. Like, for example, there's decafluoro, decalin, I'll say chalk. A version of that makes us good. The perfluoro version of that is completely insoluble in almost every solvent that I know. But it's a good solvent, right? And it's a cheap, it's an inexpensive, so this is F2, 4, 6, 8, 16, 17, 18, F18, decahydronaphthalene. So you can buy that from Ulrich, and it's got unique solubility. So why are fluoro solvents interesting? Anybody? You're not being graded on your tests. So fluorocarbons have a number of uses. Can someone of you tell me what one of the uses are? Well, you know about Teflon, right? Poly tetrafluoroethylene. It's very inert. It's very slippery, so you can put it on frying pans, cookware, you can have your meal in it, toss the meal off the pan, and the surface is clean. So fluorocarbons are very inert. But there's something else that impacts oxidation chemistry, Vitaly, right? That fluorocarbons have going dissolve huge amounts of oxygen. So if you're doing reactions based on air, O2, the air we're breathing is 21% O2, 78% nitrogen, 1% everything else. But there's a lot, you know, if there's some solvents that have such a high affinity for oxygen that they'll take oxygen out of the air. So fluorocarbons dissolve huge amounts of oxygen. So if you're going to be trying to develop reactions, oxidation reactions based on O2, fluorocarbons might be attractive to you. The issue there is the same issue you have with ionic liquids. Anybody know what ionic liquids, why they're bad? Everybody knows why they're good, right? They dissolve everything. They're extremely, extremely potent solvents, right? They will dissolve organic materials, organometallic materials, and inorganic salts. But there's an issue with ionic liquids that a lot of people ignore, including conferences on ionic liquids. Anybody know what that is? They're hard to dispose of. So you use an ionic liquid and you get much faster rates because the activation energy in is brought down by such a potent salt. But what do you do after you use it? Right, if you want to be working in any city, we have a synthetic organic chemistry discipline that joined us. If you're a company and you're doing synthesis, you have to consider the whole life cycle of what you're doing on this big scale, because you have to be able to take care of your products. You don't want environmental contamination. You don't want stuff going into landfills or lakes. So that's an issue with not ionic liquids. They're otherwise very attractive. It's also an issue with fluorocarbons. They just do not degrade very well. There's not a lot of bacteria and things that will grow on fluorocarbons. But I think it would be an interesting thing to try to induce that by trying to grow bugs in a media that contains fluorocarbons. So solubility of PONs is incredibly tunable based on the counter ion. So you can go with water to things that you can make a very concentrated toluene. Alkanes are less clear. Those are the least polar solids, of course. And I think it probably is possible to dissolve alkane salts, PON salts in alkanes. But there's no reason anybody would want to do that I can see. And then you can get them dissolved in forest media, fluorocarbons, like octadeca, fluorodecalin. Okay, so cations are very important in just solubilizing PONs. And of course, if you can't dissolve something, you usually can't use it in synthesis. And it's not just synthesis. You can't use it in medicine. You usually can't use it in a number of applications. If something won't dissolve, you're usually out of business. So solubility is rather critical. And of course, you can't measure potentials, or they don't become relevant often if your material isn't soluble. You can't run a CV, for example, cyclic voltammogram, if a compound's not soluble. So to me, and you don't have to agree, but to me, almost all PON chemistry and the chemistry of many classes of compounds, organic and inorganic, starts with solubility. Good solubility to do NMR. NMR is the most structurally informative method, right up in X-ray crystallography. You can't always grow crystals and things. So NMR becomes the only multidimensional NMR and high resolution NMR can be the only method that can really tell you what's going on. So redox potentials are very important. They impact most uses of PONs, not all, but most. They haven't been potentials that is reducing the POM hasn't been important in the antiviral chemotherapy that we've done. It is important in some anti-cancer chemotherapy that we're developing right now. We haven't published it, but the redox properties of the POMs are important there. So you can't even measure potentials if they're not soluble, but there's other issues as well. So all the electrochemical techniques rely on electron transfer rates. That's ET for extraterrestrial, Steven Spielberg's movie 32 years ago. But it also means electron transfer. It was 32 years ago to 82. So that's 80, 34 years ago, or 35. Do you guys see ET? Everybody. That's why Spielberg's rich, right? Well, so electrochemical methods are dependent on getting fast electron transfer rates between the electrode, working electrode, and your compound. And there's problems with many classes of compounds. One of them are the Keplers, the giant PONs that are based on reduced molybdenum. Starnbach and Mueller did many groups of study. The issue there is you don't get good electrochem because, well, I've seen examples. We had a couple of posters here in CB, but it's hard because they have huge charges, and so they come with a huge number of counterions. So when you have that, you can't get the PoF close to the electrode because it's surrounded by cations and they don't conduct. Not usual ones like tetrahydroammonium or whatever. Alkaline metals that are hydrated can conduct electricity. It's that happens in nature and in the chemistry lab. Oh, okay. So now there's a whole business of interaction. So POMs, and including their commercial and commercialized uses now, as I mentioned in the first lecture, there's several major processes that are commercial now using POMs. Obviously, if you're doing a reaction of any kind that involves multiple interactions. And again, as I know, POMs, the commercialized uses involve, are usually their POMs as acids. So you start with a heteropoly acid, which is a proton salt H+. And the cation is hydronium ion, right? It's a protonated water. It's because water is more basic than the POM oxygens. So that's not too good an acid catalyst because effectively it's the same as HCl or nitric acid or sulfuric acid in water. But if you drop off all the water, then the proton has to move from the water molecule, water, H2O, to the POM oxygens. And the pKa of protonated POMs is extremely low. So those are super acids, and they'll protonate almost everything, including benzene. HCl will not protonate benzene. H2SO4 will not protonate benzene. HClO4, I don't think, will. Maybe anhydrous HClO4 perchloric acid might. The POMs will do, and that's why they're the acid forms of the POMs are useful industrially. They're also oxidation catalysts. So you guys know, and you've seen talks where the POMs, not the giant wheels, started with Dr. Mueller over here, GM poster. They're kind of dead in redox-wise, at least in having potentials and electron transfer rates that are making valuable in catalysis. Though I think more needs to be done. So the counterions are going to impact, you know, interactions with everything. So POMs on surfaces is important. I'm sure.
So could you explain on the second part how are we exploiting the redox potential for antiviral and anti-cancer properties?
Sure. So the antivirals don't use redox properties. POMs inhibit all the viruses, HIV, HSV, HPV, RSV, on and on and on, Ebola. They're all inhibited electrostatically. So what you need to inhibit these, and I can show that one slide again, HIV protease that I showed at the beginning. But they work by being large, having a high charge. And this is important for a number of other phenomena, including SOMs, which you guys do, and clinical problems.